The 2020 Democratic candidates will almost certainly have to answer questions about the latest controversy enveloping their party. Her name is Congresswoman Ilhan Omar. Amy Klobuchar, in fact, was asked about Omar's controversial remarks at South by Southwest today. She said she did not agree with them entirely. So despite passing a resolution this week meant to put her offensive remarks behind them, Democrats did anything but. The past few weeks gave Omar, Congress, and really all of us, an opportunity to do a few important things. One, have a difficult conversation about the role Israel plays in U.S. politics. Two, discuss the particularly odious scourge of anti-Semitism in the United States, what it is and what it isn't. Three, take on substantive debates about actual policies involving Israel. Well, congratulations, America, we did none of the above. Despite saying that she wanted to have difficult conversations about Israel's influence, Ilhan Omar has done no such thing. In fact, in trafficking almost exclusively in patently anti-Semitic tropes about Jews, money, and dual allegiance, Omar steps all over her own stated mission. And despite repeated warnings from her Democratic and Jewish colleagues to be more careful with her language, she has only gone in the opposite direction. Likewise, Congress had the opportunity to denounce anti-Semitism, a very specific, very odious problem for the far right and the far left, and Democrats decided to dodge that opportunity, unapologetically dressing up a resolution as anti-hate and insulating the person it was meant to discourage. Republicans who voted no on that discrete basis may have a point, but they only looked partisan in the process. And finally, there have been practically zero substantive debates about actual policies involving Israel. Policies ranging from U.S. aid to Israel to the boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement. That's gotten little, if any, attention at all in all of this. And including from the person who once again says she wants to have the difficult conversations. In fact, when asked about her support of an actual policy, here's what Ilhan Omar had to say.
What is for BDS? What is for BDS?
All right, thanks.
Here's the deal. It is not anti-Semitic to question or criticize our relationship with Israel, nor is it anti-Semitic to question or criticize Israeli politics. Israeli Jews do this every day. That is a straw man argument. But when Ilhan Omar, a U.S. congresswoman, uses centuries-old anti-Semitic tropes again and again as a pretense for having difficult conversations and then refuses to have those conversations, there's no question as to what is going on here. And Democrats, shame on you. Shame on you for protecting her. It should not be this hard to swiftly condemn both the language and the person who chooses repeatedly to use it. And don't bother tweeting at me. I'll save you the time. Yes, I also denounced Republicans' protection of the human cancer, Steve King. Okay, joining me now to discuss all of this is Anti-Defamation League CEO Jonathan Greenblatt. I'm so glad you're here, Jonathan. Look, you and I have talked about this before. I welcome conversations about Israel. I know you do too. Why do you think it's so hard, though, for this congresswoman to initiate those important conversations without using anti-Semitic language?
Well, thank you for having me, SE. And I must say, it's somewhat inexplicable to me. As you stated at the top of the broadcast, we have tough conversations about Israel all the time. This wasn't about Israel. The charge that Jews somehow have an allegiance to a foreign power is deeply anti-Semitic. It predates the state of Israel. It's been used to slander and marginalize and discriminate against Jewish people for hundreds and hundreds of years. And we should keep in mind that not only is it anti-Semitic, it's anti-American. This charge was used to discriminate against German Americans during the First World War. It was used to intern Japanese Americans during the Second World War. It was used to marginalize John F. Kennedy when, as an American
and
Catholic,
Catholics.
He ran for president in 1960. So this isn't new. It is ugly. It is tired, and it doesn't belong.
Jonathan, I want to ask you about BDS because it's a movement that is steeped in anti-Semitism. Its goal is to delegitimize and villainize the Jewish state. Explain why people should be as concerned about this policy, which Omar supports, as they are about her tweets.
Well, yes, the BDS movement, this idea of boycotting Israel. It's a form of delegitimization. And delegitimization has been used by anti-Semites to discriminate against the Jewish people, literally for thousands of years, questioning their legitimacy. Now, instead of the Jewish people, this policy seeks to question the Jewish state. But it's the same old charges. As you said, the people behind it have deeply anti-Semitic motives. They seek to deny solely the Jewish people the right of self-determination. And by the way, it doesn't seek a two-state solution. It doesn't seek Palestinian-Israeli engagement. It spends its time demonizing the single Jewish state in the world. We find that deeply problematic.
And to be fair, she says she does support a two-state solution, so that doesn't really square with her support of BDS. But again, we haven't been able to talk to her about it. I don't really know what she thinks of that. What do you make of the resolution in Congress denouncing basically all hatred? Is that the proper response less than 5 months after a horrific shooting in an American synagogue?
Yeah, the most violent anti-Semitic attack in American history. I guess I have a few thoughts on it. So first of all, there was some good in the resolution. It's good that it called out anti-Semitism. It's good that it specifically called out this smear of dual loyalty. Those things were important and a good step. But here's the bad news. Number one, it shouldn't have taken this long. We shouldn't debate calling out bigotry when it happens. Congress should be quick and clear and call it out. And secondly, this debate, what is there to debate about? Look, at the ADL, we fight all forms of hate. We've been doing it for over 100 years. I've defended Congresswoman Omar when she was smeared by that poster in West Virginia last weekend.
Right.
I've stood up for Syrian refugees. I've called out this whole idea of a Muslim registry. But the notion that we have to somehow take an issue which was about anti-Semitism this week and sort of all lives matter it, we can do better than that. Congress can do better than that.
Thank you, Jonathan. Really appreciate being here.
Thank you.
Now I want to bring in our panel, senior columnist at The Daily Beast, Matt Lewis, and Democratic strategist Maria Cardona. Matt, let's get the elephant out of the room. President Trump has weighed in on this.
The Democrats have become an anti-Israel party. They've become an anti-Jewish party, and that's too bad.
I mean, that is both demonstrably, provably false. And not probably the best tack to take here.
Well, look, I think Donald Trump should stay out of this. Mm. But I think there is something to be said for that this being sadly like a canary in a coal mine, and maybe the way the Democratic Party is headed toward a Corbynite Labor Party in Britain.
I've heard this comparison.
And the reason is that, I mean, look, Nancy Pelosi is the Speaker of the House, but Nancy Pelosi's refusing to call this out specifically. There's a resolution that passed that didn't specifically condemn Representative Omar. Basically, what we have is Omar using these very old anti-Semitic tropes, being defended by AOC. Mm-hmm. And guess who's the future of the
and
party?
Others.
It's
mm-hmm.
not Nancy Pelosi.
Yeah.
AOC has more Twitter followers than Nancy Pelosi.
Well,
this is the wave. That's
and
my
and Maria, Nancy Pelosi mm-hmm. has defended Omar. She chose an interesting defense yesterday, saying that Omar has a different experience mm-hmm. in the use of words.
Mm-hmm.
I would just add, over and over and over again, despite being told to choose better words, should she maybe be on a different committee than Foreign Affairs?
Well, here's what I'll say. Let's step back, because everybody keeps saying that the Democrats let her off easy. They didn't. She was given very tough talking to's, and publicly, Nancy Pelosi publicly said,
"She is still talking."
She apologized twice. Okay. Now, the reason why I think it's so ill-advised for the president to jump in on this is he is somebody, as you know, who has used anti-Semitic tropes in his tweets.
Yes.
He was the one that in Charlottesville said there are good people on both sides.
And we remember all of
right.
That.
Exactly. But where's the Republican outrage on that? Now,
Wait a second. We've spent 3 years on CNN talking pretty extensively mm-hmm. about Donald Trump's failings. And
you have.
A lot of us have.
But Republicans in Congress don't do it.
Well,
but
Steve, there was a resolution against Steve King.
Here's
against
what I don't like. All
after
of us
how many years, though,
but no
Matt.
Offense to Maria, I understand. Yeah. But now we've hijacked a conversation to talk about Trump. I want to talk about what she said.
So,
it's deeply offensive. She's apologized.
It is
she
deeply
keeps
offensive.
Saying it. She keeps doing it.
And she needs to change her ways.
Have not effectively put this behind them, dealt with it. I'm not convinced she's not going to say something like this again.
Well, and this is something that she is going to be held to account, right?
By whom?
Well,
when? Where?
If she keeps saying it, she will have to be held to account by her own party, because I don't think Democrats...
Wasn't this that opportunity?
Well, because she had just said it, and there are things that she did say that I think merit, to your point at the very beginning, a much broader conversation.